Journalism is roundly and routinely blamed by presidents, paupers, and publicans for the world's ills. And why not? My profession has been filled with racist and sexist or misogynist content for more than a century. It has endorsed dictators and violence. It has acted in the interests of the few against our stated core belief to comfort the afflicted. And journalism is so broad and all-encompassing a term that almost anyone and anything can don the hat and excuse peeping through the curtains and writing about what's going on behind them. The term fake news represents a particular challenge because it is an attack on the profession from what most would or should acknowledge as being outside pretenders. It is also used to dismiss legitimate attempts at reporting and construct artificial universes, ones built on the attacker's own particular and usually unknowable motives. But the perceived illegitimacy of good traditional reporting, as opposed to the minority of our criminal, unethical, or racist elements, started from our own inability and unwillingness to distinguish between fact and opinion. Even before social media took hold, The Guardian launched Comment is Free in 2006 and has become a dominant part of their online push. It helped them very successfully ascend as one of the top news websites in the world. There is now comment on any and all subjects. If everyone loves a TV show or film, The Guardian will find the one person to say the opposite. And that gets clicks. But I believe it had another effect, to blur the line between fact and opinion. It's fine for The Guardian to harken back to a core founding position, comment is free, but facts are sacred. But the publication undermined facts constantly through pushing opinion and, whether rightly or wrongly, drove a constant questioning of any expertise, fact, or authority. Meanwhile, Facebook and Google algorithms reward the viral as opposed to notions of quality or effort on the part of the originator of the content. In many pockets of the UK, there are more public relations staff at individual institutions than there are at local reporters. If you are outnumbered and outpaid, how much do you need to rely on, let's call them constructed facts, through official statements and responses, as opposed to more traditional facts obtained by on-the-ground reporting? Who defines news? Who gets to assign blame? Who should ask questions? When should we pause to learn or ask or consider? Is there a role for empathy or compassion? These aren't just broad questions. These are fundamental to discussing facts and what I will introduce as factual sovereignty. And this is a really, really quick summary of where this idea came from. There is proper citation in the paper, but it originally came from a talk at the Centre for Contemporary Arts in Glasgow last November by visual artist and researcher Asunin. I totally mispronounced her first name, Melinas Gordo. She proposed a model of cultural sovereignty based on the idea of food sovereignty by Peter Rosset in 1996. During her talk, one of the things she said was, if each of us thinks of ourselves as a cultural producer, and that was the key bit for me. So if each of us thinks of ourselves as a cultural producer, could each of us think of ourselves as a factual producer? For years, there has been an online growing assertion that I know I'm right, with little challenge except for yelling, much of that encouraged by TV news. And it resulted in a viewing, reading public that were no longer a universal public, but instead living in isolation. Social media and its societal extensions in the real world don't require you to believe anything unless you want to believe it. When there is an agreement between sovereign states of facts in the forms of retweets or mass-produced placards or hats, this can be considered fact treaties. The facts continue to act independently, and I've totally realized that this page is out of sequence. I should have numbered these. That's right. So yes, factual sovereignty. That's what the cultural sovereignty one looked like. You can see that there's the dominant model and the cultural sovereignty model. Let's try that again. Factual sovereignty is a declaration by an individual, group, or organization that their facts are separate and free from those belonging to others. It is divisible, fluid, and beyond challenge. A lie, in pre-factual sovereignty days, meant a statement that was given while known to be untruthful. Now a lie is impossible, because an individual or group can merely hold that their current facts were sovereign to those held by others, or to their own facts at an earlier time. Their future facts can also be sovereign. Sovereignty allows for the constant redefining of one's own facts, we hold these truths to be self-evident only applies to what you choose to be true. Declare sovereignty and you can ignore the truths of others. They are only self-evident if you hold them yourself. And that's where the page should have gone. when there is an agreement between sovereign states of facts in the forms of retweets or mass-produced placards, this can be considered fact treaties. The facts continue to act independently, but can trade in mutual support and reassurance. Need a backup to your facts? Draw on your treaties on social media to support them. If you feel inclined to believe climate change, you are in an alliance or treaty with those who hold those facts to be true. There have always been individuals or institutions that refuse to believe what the scientific fact or measured proofs, self-declared or actual experts. But where once a majority accepted facts or proofs, individuals now declare their facts as sovereign to those of others. The media only reports the truth if it is a fact already known by those held by the audience. A person does not have their own self-worth unless someone else assigns them that value. So to some, the homeless only have value when a racist declares we should care about our own homeless before refugees. By the same token, you can call the statement or the speaker racist, but that's your designation, or perhaps that of a court. It is a fact determined by your sovereign views of someone else. There might be a collective treaty establishing that the statement or the person is racist, but it remains an externally determined fact. And it's a mistake of the current attitude that many of your sovereign enemies in this treaty idea are either too stupid to know the correct treaty to make or are calculating. But it's not possible. They can innocently or genuinely make a treaty, and they are entitled to. Regardless of the assumptions, it's declaring vast swathes of persons as inhuman, illegitimate, or incapacitated because of one or several treaties. Of course, in much of the world where individuals are denied voting rights, incarcerated at higher rates, killed because of gender or race, treaty choices can be incidental to dehumanization or central to it. This is a form of war between sovereign actors expressed through a range from angry, derogatory, or criminal tweets to extrajudicial killings. Factual sovereignty is driven by individuality in particular, but if it is all about the individual, does that make it subjective? Perhaps now the subjective-objective dichotomy has been turned inside out. If your agreement or treaty with a fact is made in the digital space, then it is disconnected from humanity. It can exist forever, irrespective of place or the original actor who created the sovereign fact. This new digital sovereign nation of facts is set apart from any of its constituent actors' subjects and can therefore be objective truth. Even if it's just a nation of one, its facts are objective truth thanks to that isolating and digital space. The consumer of content is supreme with the producers of content because they decide whether to acknowledge its existence, then judge its worth or truth. This has been advocated for many years by the press axiom of give the people what they want. Now consumers can spin their own reality. Like the analogy of the tree in the forest, if the audience doesn't click content about an event, that event didn't happen. There are no factually sovereign individuals willing to agree the event happened. If one factually sovereign individual says it did happen and five said it didn't, then the will of the majority holds sway and it didn't happen. It's a variation of the court case where the jury decides the facts. The accused and the complainer may argue as factual. What the accused and the complainer argue as factual can be different in turn from the agreed decision of the jury. Each party is factually sovereign, and within the jury itself, the members can agree or not. And if the accused refuses to accept that verdict, they can challenge it and it may be found in time to be incorrect if a judge or panel decide that the objective truths of the jury members were not in treaty with their own objective truths, whether in fact or in law. The belief that a sovereign fact is true is central to turning the formerly subjective into the new objective. Telling someone they're wrong isn't enough to dissuade them from that belief. Subjectivity has been turned on its head. In additions 62 to 64 of Justice League of America, Wonder Woman encounters two equally valid but conflicting truths. At an impasse, it shatters her lasso of truth. How can she protect truth if truth is subjective? And then people's beliefs become manifest. The more people that believe a fact, the stronger the change in reality. The earth becomes flat for a few hours. Criminals are let go by saying they didn't commit crimes. The moon is made of cheese. Batman pops in and out of existence because, to some, he's an urban myth. The whole Justice League change to reflect how society sees them. Once you begin to frame things within the factually sovereign model, you remove the handbrake on a reality that careens out of control. And we must push it along so we can see its extreme. Because at its furthest potential, factual sovereignty brings a near endless war across a nihilistic void. There would be no lies, no hypocrisy, no abuse, no crime, no courts, no hate, no adultery, no love. That is, unless it was imposed by extremist political or religious doctrines imposing truth. Now, some journalism thinkers advocate the primacy of speed in reporting, making truth a process. WikiLeaks likes to push information where the origin of the subject matters more than its truth or accuracy. We'll assess it later. Truth in this approach, and more widely, is defined as something stated in the past, which remains true at all moments in the present, until there is an abstract and unknown or unpredictable future correction. But this model presumes that only a singular fact is true in a linear temporal model. And factual sovereignty dictates any actor can assert any truth anywhere and at any time, breaking out from the linear progression. The individual is entirely in control. They have been handed the tools with which to determine facts they like or dislike. Each interaction on social media, and sometimes conflicting ones, is a new factually sovereign moment, and each is connected to a single or multiple actors. The splintering effect would look the same as a string theory of temporal choices. And thanks to my partner for doing up this graphic, there's really no easy way to try to represent this idea. We've tried. The swathes of retweets can either agree and be in treaty, or disagree and be at war with the original fact. If one group is larger, is that sufficient domination for the original statement to be determined true or false? If journalism fails to report, replicate, or mirror perfectly all the multiple sovereign truths, then is it biased? Is it fake news? Given the only way to express truth of the factual sovereignty string map, or multiverse, would be to replicate it exactly, and given that that is impossible because the multiverse is constantly changing and evolving, then reporting, or journalism, in all forms is dead. Discourse, too, is dead. Communicating the world around us is impossible because of the shifting sands of information, simultaneously stationary and moving, infinitely replicated and unique, true and false, fixed in time, and rejected because of its relative position in time. It'd be more akin to a subatomic particle than a presidential tweet. And like subatomic particles, subatomic physics, you only have to describe the potential states of existence, not the existence of fixed and knowable states, or in this case, facts. Factual sovereignty can offer instant gratification, asserting what's true or not, but the multiverse is too complex to understand, constantly in flux, ripping apart any stable notions. And so treaties give you an opportunity to plot a trajectory, a path through that bonkers map, and you simply push forward and ignore the contradictions. And the changing factual sovereign moments to assert a stability which is by definition impossible. If you believe it to be there, allowing and requiring you to dismiss any challenge or contrary sovereignty, it assumes war with all others because it is the only hope of maintaining a stable thread of self. There are examples of good factual sovereignty. They're in the paper, and I've had to cut most of them out for the presentation because it's too long. But one example I want to focus on is in courts of law. This is a quote from a defense solicitor just last week in a case where he was telling the jury, it's not a fact until you decide it is. In 2016, I covered a case involving sexual assault and sending sexual messages to girls under the age of 16. Hannah, not her real name, was one of the survivors, age 13 at the time of the offenses. Of the charges of which she gave evidence in court, three were guilty by majority, one was not proven, Scottish verdict, and one not guilty by a majority. That makes a complex mix of agreements and rejections of facts by a jury of 15 people. Hannah, who's now 18, told me for this paper, sorry for the spacing on that one, the people who said things weren't true in my case didn't know my side of the story. In a court of law, people distinguish what did and didn't happen is a lot easier because they know the full story, but on social media, nobody knows both sides. In a court of law, a jury hears from both witnesses and the defendant, so they can form a fair opinion, but people online can't, purely as they don't know the facts. And there's a full set of Q&A with Hannah in the paper, if you want to see her other perspectives. Right, the truth of a court case witness is just as easily rejected by a jury as a tweet by Trump. A judgment is made on truth by 12 or 15 or 60 million or a billion people. Why is it believed or disbelieved? How are we meant to report accurately when 2 or 10 or millions may reject a truth, but it remains true for one individual? This approach to understanding the mass individualization of facts is not an endorsement of the content of Pizzagate, or the Hillsborough lies printed by the Sun, of Holocaust denial, or any such lie in fiction, but that individuals advocate them as true, whether meaningfully or for attention, is undeniable. Simply stating they aren't true is no longer sufficient because to those sovereign entities, no amount of evidence is enough to surrender their sovereignty and agree with that of someone else. The root of journalism is asking questions, and those ideally open questions, tell me what happened, are identical to those of mediation or peace building. The only difference between the professions is journalism reports on the conflict, mediation tries to resolve it. Reporters can, I believe, do both. We are ideally placed to ask questions and to bring people together face to face, not just digitally. Mediation is the term, but empathy and compassion are the root necessities. Understanding the positions of others is a core requirement of journalism. Think of us as the translators of a United Nations of factually sovereign actors. We put them in a room, act as go-betweens, and see what treaties emerge. Mediation is always voluntary. We cannot force someone to talk nor to listen. But the invitation should be made. There are challenges, of course, in mediation with potential power imbalance, whether on gender, racial, employment, economic lines. How does mediation avoid the "I told you so" triumphalism that drives people sovereign? How can journalism inform without preaching? Or should it preach? Is the job of informing inherently preaching and imposing a dominant sovereign position on other sovereignties? Like reporters, mediators are meant to be entirely neutral. So rather than solutions journalism, which is one branch of journalism we have now, or endless commentaries from The Guardian, where we tell others how to fix the world, we need to bring others together so they can decide how to fix it. And I would argue there's almost nobody above questioning or meeting face to face. If we believe in religious notions of redemption, then nobody is sufficiently fallen that they are to be isolated from communication by anyone save God herself. They are not beyond mercy. And if human rights have replaced, for example, the Bible as a new theology, then Article 3 of the European Convention on Human Rights says to 820 million people, no one shall be subjected to torture or to inhumane or degrading treatment or punishment. It is a guarantee to all, not some, even those we find abhorrent. Whether on that mass scale of forgiveness or the extreme end of recovery from human fallacy, then we can communicate. If not directly to each other, then through mediators, whether that be reporters or reporters working as formal mediators. Because if we don't believe that, if your factual sovereignty excludes both religious and legal notions of redemption and forgiveness, then the fractured and multiverse of infinite simultaneous truths beyond any agreement is the result. The UN doesn't cease to exist because some nations go to war or commit crimes or abstain from engagement. Though flawed, it continues. Journalism can be the United Nations, reporters the diplomats. They translate between different languages of sovereignties so they can communicate between each other. Rather than safe spaces, reporters should offer, as I believe is a guiding principle, to comfort the afflicted and afflict the complacent. Confronting those who are factually sovereign from you requires effort, patience, and empathy. The inequalities inevitably present in such clashes of sovereignty, racial, gender, economic, etc., require an absolute commitment by the reporter not to judge, but to enable communication. And journalism is communication, and turning on comment sections or engagement on Facebook is not. Meeting people in person, asking questions, and exploring what makes a person unique, not sovereign, must return to being our prime objective. So for too long, we have been, yes, subjective, driven by ourselves as the subject or by the building up or tearing down of another person as the subject. The new objectivity should instead mean our goal to be mediators and communicators, both ethically and factually. And finally, consider the words of American poet Wallace Stevens. There is one most welcome and authentic note. It is the insistence on a reality that forces itself upon our consciousness and refuses to be managed and mastered. It is here that the affinity of art and religion is most evident today. Both have to mediate for us a reality, not ourselves. This is what the poet does. The supreme virtue here is humility, for the humble are they that move about the world with the love of the real in their hearts. Thank you.